Now back to more of Matt Fox's Game Room. We're grown men and we're a few beers in. Viewer discretion is advised.
Okay, so now we have moved the camera and we're over to another section of Super Nintendo games. Look how many there are, folks.
And there's lots more below.
And there's lots more below.
We're only going to waste height here so far. Just the whole way down.
I'll put in all this stuff later, you know. Magic. So what are some of the your picks from here that you'd like to show from this section?
Well, you just mentioned two R-Type 3, behind the scenes kind of stuff. Great game, bullet hell shooter. Q-Bert, big fan of that from the Coleco days. Always the ones that stand out.
I like colored Super Nintendo cartridges. Some people don't.
Although it's got the dreaded LJN on it.
Ooh, LJN.
But this one is actually good.
Yeah. You know what?
You learned a lesson.
Matt is zero LJN defender. Defend that one. Because this is a pretty good one. So it shouldn't be too hard of a job for you. But yeah, Maximum Carnage, red cartridge. Yes. Just like Doom has the red cartridge. Killer Instinct has black cartridge. Yeah. What other color cartridges are there?
That's it for Super Nintendo, really.
Is it only, like, how many count one hand?
All right, Doom, the Black Art, Killer Instinct, and Separation, right?
Maximum Carnage. Separation and Anxiety is a great cartridge.
Oh, that's right. Yep.
Those are the only color ones.
Interesting. So, yeah, there's not that many actual different cartridge ones. Mm-hmm.
And then we're looking at games that didn't have the title on the top label.
Yeah, also we were talking about games that doesn't have the title and label. Do you see any there?
No, for the Super Nintendo, there wasn't that many that didn't have a top label.
Jordan got one, though.
I picked up X-Zone, which is a Super Scope game, and I'm going to be doing a Super Scope series. That's why I'm picking them all up.
Oh, okay. You're a brave, brave man.
All I need is Lemmings 2, which Matt actually needs that too.
Oh, nice.
And when a guy who has this many games needs a game, and that's one of the games you need, then you feel bad. Because this guy should have them.
He should.
Don't pay your bills, Matt.
That's right.
Buy games.
Don't pay your bills.
Screw it. But what else was I talking about? Yeah, Super Scope games.
I have X-Zone.
You have X-Zone. How do you know? Because it doesn't say it on the label, does it?
No, I don't have it.
Does it? No, that's on your list of games you don't have.
Yeah, so I don't have that.
No?
I was scared when I sent him the picture of my copy of X-Zone that he'd say he wanted it.
Yeah, mine!
No, it's not there.
But is that the only one that you can see out of your collection?
Yeah, honestly, without... Yeah.
Interesting.
But apparently there's more. My buddy, Yoshi Knuckles, you said that there's more, so... Yeah, apparently there's more. But we were talking about different colored cartridges, and what better segue than why don't we jump to your N64 collection,
Boom.
Matt?
Oh, he's got a good point there.
Because N64
Matt has done something to his N64 collection that is a very nice touch. I haven't seen anybody else do this. Matt's the only guy I've seen do this, I think you guys are going to appreciate this.
Just wait, kids. Okay, so now we are at the N64 part of the collection, and how many N64 games do you have there, Matt?
Every one of them.
Every N64
That's
game,
it,
folks.
Like no panache behind that, just every one.
Every one, just it's done. Every game, excluding, Clay Fighters, Sculptor's Cut.
Excluding?
Including.
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 Oh,
yeah,
very nice.
Excluding, I would have, because it's Blockbuster, it's like, but yeah, they're all here, including a cigar for a promotional item for Conker's Bad Fur Day from Pete Dyack from the VGCC.ca.
Yeah, here's a cool little official Nintendo cigar.
And like tobacco and Nintendo.
Nintendo, who does products for kids.
They're not good best friends.
Made a cigar. Yeah, that's pretty cool for Conker's Bad Fur Day, which is on my list. I gotta get that game. And what are like some of the most hardest N64 games to get?
Okay, right now, so you got Conker's Ogre Battle.
Ogre Battle 64,
International Superstar Soccer.
A sports
which
game.
Year was it? 2000, yeah.
It was 2000.
It was really hard to find, and Pete, again, props to that guy.
Pete Diak, VGCC.ca.
That's it there. And great condition, too, so you found
and,
that.
And don't forget to mention, look at there's a top label on all of this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Show them the top labels.
you'll see in the pan shot, but for this one, each N64 label here, well, let me wait for autofocus. Look at that. That is probably the best display and label for an N64 I've seen. When you said that you had them end labeled, I thought it was just going to be text.
Hey, Nintendo.
This?
Nintendo, I'm calling you out. Why didn't you do that with your 64 games?
What were you
games?
Thinking?
Yeah, well, Nintendo.
Laminate
what's
your
wrong with you?
You stupid.
You did it with all your other consoles.
Hashtag
what's the matter?
At Nintendo, they're going to see this. So yeah.
Other games that were great, like honestly, like, well, Spider-Man was fun to like play it in the Dreamcast, and then anything on Dreamcast.
If you were to play an N64 game, what would be the one you'd pick out?
Right now, Blast Corps.
Is that a good game? I see it's pretty affordable. I need to get that one.
Old Standby, GoldenEye, Perfect Dark, and Zelda's of course. But there's little hidden gems too, like...
pick out a hidden gem here.
I actually just named it with Blast Corps. What did you call?
I'm going to go Star Wars Rogue Squadron.
Empire.
Yeah.
Shadows of the Empire. Yeah. Mario 64. I always go to that because I love the opening levels theme. Always. I love it.
But hidden
64?
Gem
Wars?
Yeah.
Hidden gem. How many RPGs are there on the N64?
Three or four.
Zelda and Majora's Mask are the only real ones that really stand out.
That's
there's
like
Quest 64. Quest 64.
Like RPGs for like Ogre Battle, right?
Yeah, Ogre Battle. That's a strategy RPG.
Yeah.
What else did they have on
Paper
there?
Mario.
Paper Mario. Those are very underrated. Of course, Smash Brothers is a very popular one on the 64 because
that's where
Smash Brothers originated was on the 64, and not a lot of people know that. And Paper Mario also started on the 64.
Some kids are just born now after all this stuff was made, so it's like, it's weird.
Get off your tablets, get some wired controllers, and get to it.
Yeah, consoles, kids! Okay, well that's N64 collection. What are we moving on to next, Matt?
We are on to the... A bunch of stuff. TurboGrafx.
A bunch of stuff.
ColecoVision and Atari.
Let's reset the camera! Okay, Matt, tell us what we got here, buddy.
Okay, no problem. We have a bit of a mixed bag. So this is my nostalgia at its core, being ColecoVision, which is what I played as a kid. That was my first video game system. I was born in 76. So you can get the idea of when 83 was, the crash of the video game.
Do you have all the Coleco?
No.
Yeah, Mousetrap?
Yes, absolutely. Great game.
I love that one. That's a game I actually used to play with my family. Well,
same
we had
here.
The ColecoVision.
Yep. I've never played it.
That was up.
You never played ColecoVision.
Yeah,
no.
You have to try it one day. You have to at least try it.
Yeah, we'll pull it out.
Is a system too. I love to collect for it because I played it. But the problem is it had.
Oh shit! That means.
Oh, we got a ringer. Right. Somebody didn't turn the ringer off.
Fucking
Oscar, you're fired.
So you had the Chuck Norris titles and the.
Oh, what Chuck Norris? Holy fuck, man! Holy fuck! It's the Chuck.
But there's
I've never heard of this. This is amazing.
But the Coleco had, like, the ones they kind of officially produced had beautiful, everything's the same, looks good. But then they got into weird stuff, like they got into this bullshit. You know, mine.
No top labels.
Yeah. And then,
no top label. Worst pet peeve of any collector.
Great system. The lawsuits that went onto it, like they built like modules that played Atari games, and they won in court. They shouldn't have, but it didn't matter. They're helping Atari in the end of it. But so back at the top, we have Atari 5200. So it was a strange system overall. Bad label tops. It looks like N64 took a piece from that history. Said, hey,
no end label.
Yeah, it's just strange. But 7800, another failed attempt by Atari.
There is one there with an end label. What's that?
Congo Bongo. Very, very good game.
Let's show Congo Bongo. I don't know what Congo Bongo is.
Sega? I don't know if you've heard of them or not. But...
Oh, by Sega.
Yeah,
I'll hear this upside down. It's weird that the label is upside down even though like that's the title label.
Yeah.
But this is the way it goes. It usually goes the other way.
Strange.
Yeah, Congo Bongo. That's weird.
It was higher than a kite when they made these games. Anyways, long story short, that's something I didn't really get into because the controllers were brutal. They're broken from the get-go. Centering issues are a problem. So I have games. I don't have the system actually. Otherwise, 7800 had the system. Play 2600 games. back on another failed attempt by Atari. We have the
Jaguar.
Yep, Atari Jaguar.
Ooh, Atari Jaguar.
Funky Donkey, great for inserting in, grip on the top.
I don't think I've actually seen many of these carts ever. I don't think I've ever seen these carts in real life.
Actually, this is, it's funny, two stories here. Coleco was my first system I collected, or had as a kid, as the first game in my collection I ever owned that was not a classic was this one here, Wolfenstein 3D. So I was working at Microplay, and I said, hey, that's kind of cool. How much is this? The guy's like, $2. Like,
this is one of like your first games, guys?
That's the first game in my collection of starting to do the retro thing. Yeah.
And,
Wolfenstein 3D.
That was one of the better versions of Wolfenstein,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, Doom was a funny one all around, but this Wolfenstein version was just great. It was spectacular.
That was the precursor to Doom.
Yes, it was. And
you got some Jaguar CD there.
Not many, but a few. Not that there was that many in the library, but yeah, those are it there. And guess what?
He actually has a Jaguar CD that works.
One that works, that's right.
That doesn't have shit all over it.
That's right. And we'll do a video in the future. We'll show off all the systems that's video modded and such. Mm-hmm. But the Charlie Jaguar CD wasn't a big fan because it was, cardboardy, CD. But they were good. Loading was a bit slow. Coleco, which we talked about, a lot of great games. This is another thing that showcases a complete TurboGrafx-16 collection, minus the cardboard box that came with it.
Complete.
That's right, kids. He said a complete set of TurboGrafx-16 games. That's every single one.
But, like the trick with anything, say like Jackie Chan, which came out near the end, they didn't have a actual jewel case with it. Yep.
Jackie Chan, action kung fu.
And the other part is this. So I found a guy that had, he knew that basically TurboGrafx at the end, to save money, they would pull off the spine and just a loose cart, which is a HU cart, a sleeve and the manual. And then it came in the cardboard. So they got rid of the jewel case idea. So this guy designed these at the end. So you just put them on as like a vinyl adhesive, which is
a sticker.
Still not on there 100%. And then boom, it's, at least you can read the title of the side. Otherwise it'd be blanks in the collection. You could read A to Z on what the title is.
Yeah, and so that's interesting. That's something I didn't know about TurboGrafx-16 is that they stopped producing the spine label.
He wasn't kidding about having a complete TurboGrafx run, and he's about to prove it.
Yep, and honestly, it was a great system to collect for. My rich cousin had a TurboGrafx, only I guess Toys R Us and Radio Shack sold it. Whereas,
before you pull this out, I want to set it up.
Okay, so this collection, it was hard to complete. Chase HQ was one of my last ones to get, but one game I got very early on in the collection.
Yes, I asked Matt to pull out a game that he wanted to show off, like show and tell, and this is the game he picked. So, take it away, Matt.
Not my thing, like I like side scroller shooters, but this one is a old lady on a broomstick, and it's called Magical Chase.
Ooh, Magical Chase.
Yes,
I've heard about this being pretty sought after.
That's usually what a lot of people are wanting to get to finish their TurboGrafx-16s. It's also part of what a lot of people call cute 'em ups.
Yeah,
cute 'em up.
Side-scrolling shooters with cute characters, Japanese animation.
I have actually never heard of that, Oscar. I just learned
and the funny thing is, though, the U.S. version differs very greatly from the Japanese version. Yes, well, the U.S. version did different character textures and sprites and different backgrounds in certain levels.
Yeah,
interesting. Carmine was called.
So, how much does like
this is Magical Chase?
How much would like Magical Chase go for like loose?
3,000 to 5,000, I'm guessing. So it would be like the equivalent of the stadium events for NES. But but the thing is, technically, like that's worth a lot. But if you had the cardboard to go with it, you're looking at like 10,000 for that alone. So
still, people are looking for that game. Period.
It's like if you found that, and which I did, I found. And Bonk 3 is another one that's getting up there, and always kind of was up there. But the thing is, Bonk 3 isn't that obviously is rare enough in itself. Bonk 3 is also a great game to play because you can do two player.
Oh, nice! I didn't know that.
Yeah,
I think I've played Bonk once. One time I don't have like any experience with TurboGrafx-16, and that's why we're probably gonna have to do some videos.
It's like satellite cards. That's why people are confused. But
let's have a look at this.
Well, the TurboGrafx game that came out for the Canadian version, that was the manual. So I had to steal a Turbo Duo Bonk 3 to make it somewhat official for the complete. So yeah, that's Canadiana version.
This is like a weird manual. Like it flips open like a
map.
Yeah, like a map.
That's interesting. I did not know that.
That's cool. Here, let's just show that off.
Yeah, no problem.
So all these manuals are legit.
is what all Matt was talking about earlier, is for the display purpose of the N label, which for the N64 I think is brilliant too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so, it really helps. Like, well, what game is that? So you have to pull it out and have a look, you just know from the side. So,
yeah.
But this, honestly, of all my systems I have, this is probably my favorite. Like, Super Nintendo overall, the library, they're always fun ones to pick, but mm-hmm. this game, this system here, like, whatever game I grab, it's always a good time. You put it in, you have a laugh, and there's, like, the Galagas, there's
Oh, Galaga 90 is a great version on there.
Great, great version.
The Galaga.
The pinball games, the Devil's Crush, and even, like, Keith Courage, like it's all...
Keith Courage is the game you see in every yes. post for a TurboGrafx-16 for sale.
Yeah, it's everywhere.
It's the Mario.
It's the Mario TurboGrafx. Yeah, pack-in, so, which I think it was.
I also noticed you have a handheld there. Why don't you pull that out?
Yes.
What kind of handheld is this?
This is called a TurboGrafx Express, and it has a TV tuner as well.
Mm-hmm. TurboGrafx Express.
Here's the thing, they were ahead of
TV tuner.
Yeah. You get full color, you could play the game, save the game, come back, play it at home, like, you know what I mean? Like, I guess you couldn't save it because it wouldn't transport because it would be a shoe, but...
Like, you play the TurboGrafx-16 games on
this. Yes, it was actually a portable console.
Could you imagine back in the day being able to play Super Nintendo games portable? Wow.
The only thing is, though, the battery, this thing would eat batteries like you wouldn't believe.
And you can watch TV, so if you went to work, you pull the antenna, and then you're in action.
Yes, you can't use antennas now, kids. We're going back to the rabbit ears days, just like Oscar said.
There's a few here, nothing crazy to write home about, but there was a TurboGrafx CD. I have actually probably over half the collection, maybe three quarters. That's the CD game. So the same layout for the spines and such, and they were just CDs. Well made, well polished, but... I think this TurboGrafx CD was one of the first CD consoles.
Three Wanderers from Yeast, right?
Yeast.
Is this an exact port from the Super Nintendo?
The other way around.
Yeah. Yeast
originated on the TurboGrafx-16 and was ported to other consoles.
Yep.
Yeast 3 actually has three versions, which is the TurboGrafx version, the Super Nintendo, and the Sega Genesis version.
As well as the PC kind of there as well. The
more you know.
The thing is, the audio, like, you were talking, like, NES. Everyone's fucking around, oh, this Mario game's great, boing, boing, boing. Then you're playing full CD audio. Like, it was just, the sound was,
the
soundtrack.
Here, Valis 3.
Yes. And a lot of people don't know it, but a lot of other people do, that TurboGrafx was the first system to actually be CD-based. Precursor to the Sega CD.
Sony was just copying all these guys.
The Genesis cover was far better.
20. Probably hurt to get at those.
Madonna tits.
And then we move on to, this is a mixed bag, no joke, the Master System. So, yeah, there's a few in here overall.
On the lower shelves off camera sits Matt's Sega Master System collection. There's just over 100 games here, roughly 106 by my count, but I'm just eyeballing it.
This is the rarest of them all, James Buster Douglas. Yes, a sports game is the rarest.
James Buster Douglas Knockout Boxing. Mm-hmm. Why is this a rare game?
Because...
Oscar, fill us in on Matt's collection. Because Matt just collects them, he doesn't know about
them. I'm saying low count, but...
But this is a sports game, and a lot of people were betting on James Buster Douglas to win the title at this point, which he didn't, so the game was just kind of like... canceled when they just released whatever run they had, and then that made this rare.
Oh wow, that's pretty cool. So they were anticipating a winner, and he didn't win.
Kills you. When you're buying your Mario parties and you're paying like 60 bucks or whatever, and they were mass produced, it hurts because games that were in the 5,000 or 5,000 run, and there's like a 5 million run, like they shouldn't be that priced.
Yeah.
These games here truly should be. And this one is finally getting noted as...
Yes.
Like, I don't want to jump too much out of the platform, but I'm going to go to NES here. We were talking about earlier off camera, we were talking about Tengen Tetris and how many of those there possibly are out there in circulation. Yeah. How many did we, like, what is it?
3,000, 2,500?
Somewhere around
3,000.
That's just a guess.
I own that game, and I got it for like $65. But then you go to a game like, he said, Mario Party, that's worth the same amount, but there's millions out there.
Yeah, and people are just holding on to them.
So it's like a weird thing. Like, the retro gaming thing, you gotta know your stuff and research. It's really...
Yes, know your flea markets, know your garage sales, and,
when you can find a deal, you can jump on it. Because if you don't jump on that deal, somebody's gonna get it for a better price.
Yeah.
and sell it for a higher markup, which is, to me, it's been kind of dirty pool.
Yeah, the reseller thing.
And it's a yah, you lose. And and you want to, there's even stores that know their stuff and they miss that one hidden gem and just go in there and grab it. And talk to your retailer. Like, if you're gonna buy a few games, talk and see if you flex, can you work, the people will come back. So, anyways, that's Master System, and it continues on to the next cabinet.
Stay tuned for the next exciting video in the Matt's Game Room series.
The music in this video was composed by and provided for free use by Jason Hain. For more tunes and to leave him a voluntary tip for providing this material for use, visit www.noisetrade.com/Jason Hain.